This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning to all. Today I am going to tell you about the Strider. Before going to the Strider, we have to go with the anatomy of the larynx. In the previous PowerPoint presentation, I have told already about the anatomy of the larynx, but it will be a short form. And first about the infant larynx, it is more superior in length and epiglottis is shorter, angled more powerful glottis and vocal cords are slanted, anterior commissure more is present more inferiorly. The distinction points are mostly more superior in the neck, larynx lies more superior in the neck in the case of infants, and also it is the epiglottis is shorter and also angled more over the glottis, that is it falls over the laryngeal inlet, and the vocal cords are slanted like anterior commissure is more inferior, and like posteriorly it is more it lies more superior when compared to the anterior part, anterior commissure, and vocal process 50% of the length. That means in the normal adult the vocal ligament will be two-thirds of the total vocal movements. And also the larynx is cone shaped in the case of infant, narrowest at the subglottic cricoid ring, and softer and more pliable, and may be gently flexed or rotated anteriorly. Infant tongue is larger and head is naturally flexed. You can see in the picture here, epiglottis is present more towards the posterior side, that is covering completely the laryngeal inlet, and also the larynx is placed more superiorly. And it is a cone-shaped larynx in the case of infants. Introduction, the child labeled with the diagnosis of Strider may have significant underlying pathology, and Strider is a symptom and it's not a diagnostic part, because it only tells about the symptoms. It is only the symptom which represents the underlying condition which is present in the larynx, that is pathology, and history and general examination alone are insufficient for a firm conclusion to be drawn. And so deciding which patients to investigate is sometimes difficult. Even after non-invasive investigations such as imaging, there may remain a number of differential diagnoses. And in the acute situation, the pediatric airway can deteriorate rapidly and can prove a real challenge. And when coming to the Strider, it is only a symptom. And there can be number of conditions which cause the Strider. It can be supraglottic, glottic, or infraglottic. That is, above the vocal cords is called as supraglottic in a short way. And the glottic part is nothing but the vocal cords part, that is vocalis ligament part. And the subglottic is below the vocal cords, in the cricoid area, and below the cricoid. Whereas in the case of acute situation, the pediatric airway can deteriorate rapidly and can prove a real challenge. In the case of pediatric patients, that is in the case of children, this is an emergency condition, because we have to deal it in the emergency setup by doing any tracheostomy or other life-saving procedure, cricothyroidectomy, etc. And you know that you learned in the physics the Poisson's law and Bernoulli's principle, maintaining the pressure constant on both sides. Definitions: Strider is nothing but a noise originating in the larynx or trachea, and is typically high pitched and it may have a musical quality. It is a high pitched sound which is originating from the larynx or trachea. Larynx means supraglottis, glottis or subglottis, and the tracheal part. Wherever the constriction is present, there can be a Strider there. And in contrast, the low pitched snoring type of noise made by the nasopharynx and the oropharynx is oropharyngeal obstruction, has a rougher quality and is best described as stertor. You have to remember these two terms. Strider is nothing but it is a high pitched sound, high pitched noise which has a musical quality in character, and it is mostly due to the obstruction in the larynx or the trachea. Whereas in contrast, the stertor is nothing but a low pitched snoring type of noise. It is made by the nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal obstruction and rarely by the supraglottic larynx, and has a rougher quality and is best described as stertor. Obstruction of the small intrathoracic airway, such as the asthma, is termed as wheezing. You know that in the clinics. Smaller intrathoracic airways are nothing but the bronchioles, respiratory bronchioles, terminal bronchioles will be there. No, these are the intrathoracic airways. When collapse, it can lead to wheezing. Larynx is divided into supraglottis, glottis, and subglottis. You can see here in the picture. It is the nasopharyngeal part, and this is the supraglottis above the vocal cord part, and subglottis and or the upper trachea, and it is the lower trachea. And the supraglottic larynx comprises the epiglottis, AE folds, that is area epiglottic folds, false parts, and the ventricles. Whereas the glottis consists of vocal cords mainly, also referred to as vocal folds. In children, the subglottis extends from the under surface of the vocal cords to the inferior border of the cricoid cartilage. You have to remember this, whereas in the case of adults it changes. In the case of children, the subglottis extends from the under surface of the vocal cords to the inferior border of the cricoid, whereas in the case of adults the subglottis starts about 1 cm below the glottis, that is below the vocal cords, and then below that 1 cm part is the subglottic part. You can see here in the picture. In the nasopharynx, mostly airway noise caused by the obstruction is stutter. Voice or cry will be muffled, and the cough is typically absent in the case of nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal obstruction. Whereas in the supraglottic or glottis part, there will be a stridor, which is inspiratory mostly, and voice or cry is mostly hoarse. When the glottis is involved, it will be the hoarse in character. And in the case of cough, it is a barking type of cough. Whereas in the case of subglottics or upper trachea, the stridor is biphasic, and the voice or cry is unchanged. And in the case of cough, it is a brassy cough. And in the case of lower trachea, the stridor is expiratory type, and the voice or cry is unchanged. And in the case of cough, it is a wet sounding cough. In the subglottic and the lower tracheal part, the voice or cry is mostly not involved because of the absence of involvement of the glottis part. Whenever the glottis is involved, it leads to the hoarseness of the voice. But in the case of subglottis and the lower trachea, a glottis is not involved, but the patient has to keep effort to produce voice. Typically, inspiratory stridor is due to an extrathoracic obstruction from the larynx or the high trachea, where the bronchial or the lower tracheal obstruction produces an expiratory stridor. You can see here, typically inspiratory stridor is due to the extrathoracic obstruction from the larynx or high trachea. As I have said previously, supraglottis or glottis part can lead to the obstruction. When there is obstruction in this part, it can lead to the expiratory stridor, inspiratory stridor. In the case of bronchial or lower tracheal obstruction, produces an expiratory, that is lower airway obstruction can lead to the expiratory stridor, and biphasic stridor can occur with obstruction anywhere in the trachea bronchial. Even if expiratory stridor is absent, a prolonged expiratory phase may be present, indicating an intrathoracic obstruction. Sometimes you may not observe there is a stridor in the case of lower airways. Then there can be a prolonged expiratory phase, like in the case of asthma, where you see a prolonged expiratory phase, and because of the obstruction caused in the terminal bronchioles and bronchioles. You can see these are the evaluation points. You have to remember that is history, examination, special investigations, and you have to determine the site, cause, and severity of the stridor. History, perinatal history, the obstetric and perinatal history is often relevant to know if the child was born prematurely and require ventilation. And you have to, whenever the patient, whenever the neonate or the newborn comes to the ENT department with the case of stridor, you have to examine the neonatal causes which can lead to the stridor, like croup. We have to eliminate these all findings. Epiglottitis, we have to eliminate above all findings. On the cause of laryngomalacia, these are the causes which can lead to the newborn cases. And neonates admitted even for the short periods to intensive care or a special care baby unit may have had endotracheal intubation. History of a difficult delivery is also linked to the vocal cord palsy. We have to remember this point also. Vocal cord palsy can also be seen in the case of difficult delivery, and you have to record in the history the any previous endotracheal intubations in the case of newborns. Presentation at birth. The most common causes are the laryngeal web, subglottic stenosis, tracheal narrowing, vocal cord paralysis. Whereas first few weeks, it is mostly due to the laryngomalacia, and then gradual increase. There will be a gradual increase of the luminal airway, which can lead to the luminal growths, which can obstruct the luminal airway. Because these small causes like the laryngeal web, these will be gone at this time because of the increase in the size of the larynx. And most commonly due to the luminal obstruction is due to the hemangioma. And extrinsic causes are mediastinal masses like lymph nodal masses, thymus, which can lead to the obstruction, or also the aneurysms of the greater vessels at the entry of the thorax, which can lead to the obstruction by narrowing the airway. Pattern of stridor. Stridor is seldom constant, and laryngomalacia better when the child is at rest or asleep, and worse by crying, feeding, and excitement. Have to remember this point. Laryngomalacia, the baby is better when the child is at rest, but when the child is feeding or crying or in the excitement, it can lead to the worsening of the condition, and it can lead to the stridor. Upper airway obstruction at the level of pharynx is in contrast worse when the child is asleep and is associated with stridor, because whenever there is an upper airway obstruction, there will be inspiratory stridor, because the air which is getting into the lung can pull the mass into the larynx and can lead to the upper airway obstruction. And so in the case of a child, when the child is asleep, involuntarily the mass gets into the larynx and can lead to the obstruction and can lead to the stridor. Airway obstruction greater in the supine position with pedunculated laryngeal mass, and in conditions of the supralaryngeal obstruction such as micrographia and resultant tongue base occlusion. Improvement in the airway with crying occurs in significant nasal obstruction such as bilateral choanal atresia. You have to remember this last word, because in the case of bilateral choanal atresia, the only route through which the child can take air is the oral cavity. So whenever the child is crying, the child only takes the air through the ear. So there will be an improvement in the nasal, improvement in the stridor, improvement in the airway. When the child is silent or asleep, the child can't take breathing through the nose because of the obstruction in the choanal part, that is bilateral choanal atresia. Symptoms associated with varying causes of airway obstruction. These are the symptoms. And prolonged expiratory phase, you can see in the tracheal and bronchial obstruction, like tracheobronchomalacia and stenosis. And the cough, mostly due to the vocal cord palsy, cleft larynx, and tracheoesophageal fistula, foreign body, tracheomalacia, reflux. And in the case of aspiration, mostly the aspiration occurs because of the absence of the closure of the laryngeal inlet. It can be due to the vocal cord palsy, or there can be a fistula between the esophagus and the trachea, which can lead to the aspiration, that is tracheoesophageal fistula. And there can be cleft larynx, that is cleft larynx is nothing but there is a small longitudinal like opening between the trachea and the esophagus, through which the aspiration can occur. Next one is the hoarseness. It is a laryngeal lesion. Mostly, I have said, whenever there is a glottic involvement, it can lead to the hoarseness. Acute airway obstruction. It can be due to the retropharyngeal abscess. It can be due to the retropharyngeal abscess, tonsillitis, glandular fever, foreign body, epiglottitis, croup, and bacterial tracheitis. In the case of dysphagia and feeding difficulties, it can be due to the epiglottitis, tonsillitis, retropharyngeal abscess, newborn feeding affected with many causes of severe airway obstruction, and apnea is mostly due to the tracheobronchomalacia. Feeding history, how to ask this? because a change in feeding or inability to feed is typically keenly noted by the carers and is likely to be a key indicator of the upper airway status. Breastfed babies with airway obstruction will characteristically come up for air, and bottle-fed babies may require the thickened feeds or a slow teat, that is, one with small holes. The end result of the poor feeding may just be slow feeding, which troubles the carers more than the child, or there will be failure to thrive with remarkably poor weight gain. These 3 points are in a short form. Because of the involvement of the action muscles in the case of airway obstruction, the child keeps more effort to take the air. So there will be decrease in the activities like the taking the food or the feed. So there will be difficult for the child to take the feeds because of the fatigue of the cerebrals. General medical conditions: any history of the vocal cord palsy occurring as a result of neurological disease or cardiothoracic surgery. It may also suggest the vascular compression I have said previously, offset with the congenital cardiac disease. And there can be presence of any skin lesions is important, because a cutaneous hemangioma may be offset with subglottic hemangioma. You have to rule out this. If there is any cutaneous hemangiomas in the case of newborns, we have to rule out any hemangiomas within the upper airway obstruction. Causes of acute obstruction are croup, which is also known as the laryngotracheal bronchitis. Second one is the brachial bacterial tracheitis. Next one is the acute epiglottitis. The fourth one is the foreign body. Fifth one is the post intubation. Next one is the immediate airway obstruction postpartum. These are the acute conditions which can lead to the obstruction. And the examples of naso and oropharyngeal causes of upper airway obstruction. These are the most common causes, bold one. These are coinal atresia. Congenital causes are mostly coinal atresia and craniofacial anomalies and micrognathia, which is also glossoptosis. And acquired causes in the case of neonates are the neonatal rhinitis. And acquired causes in the case of children are allergic rhinitis, adenoiditis, adenodonsillar hypertrophy, foreign body. These are the most common causes. You should also remember about the tetrapharyngeal abscess, Ludwig's angina, and dermal or caustic bones, which are there. Another congenital causes are laryngomalacia. We have to remember this. It because most of the children can present with this condition along with the stridor. And next one is the vocal cord palsy, because of the during the delivery of the baby, which can lead to the damage to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Next one is the in the case of neonates, another condition is intubation trauma. We have to take in the history whether there is any previous history of intubation. And in the case of children, and other conditions are intubation trauma, similar to neonates. And second one is the croup. It is also most common condition. You have to rule out. The X-ray finding is nothing but the steeple side. There will be narrowing of the trachea. Another one is recurrent respiratory papillomatosis, that is, which are caused by human papilloma virus. Small papilla, which are present in the larynx, can lead to the obstruction of the upper airway or the airway. They may also spread to the distal airways like the trachea and the bronchioles. Next one is a foreign body. You have to remember this, which can lead to the obstruction and it can lead to the ball valve effect. And next one is the epiglottitis. This is nothing but thumb sign. In X-ray, you can see the thumb sign. Next one is the in the case of congenital, primary tracheomalacia, secondary tracheomalacia due to the vascular compression. Vascular compression is nothing but there can be aneurysm in the aorta, which can lead to the compression of the trachea. Next one, in the case of acquired neonate condition, post intubation or instrumentation or tracheal stenosis. And in the case of acquired children, croup, foreign body. These are the tracheal causes. And these are the laryngeal causes of the upper airway obstruction. These are the nasopharyngeal or noropharyngeal causes of the upper airway obstruction. Associated features are, as I mentioned previously, the baby or the child tries to use the action muscles, and so there will be subcostal, intercostal or suprasternal recession may occur separately or together, and also be associated with the seizure respiration. The severity of the restriction is a better indicator of severity of the airway compromise. You can also see this point in the case of pediatrics. And in the case of axillary muscles of respiration are not usually employed by the Enger child, who depends predominantly on the diaphragmatic movement. And the nasal flaring and head bobbing are important and concerning signs, as is the abnormal posturing. Head bobbing is nothing but forward and backward movement of the baby's head. And nasal flaring is nothing but enlargement of the ala of the nasal, that is external nose. And the child may adopt a position of the neck extension and in some instances head rotation with airway obstruction as the position of the greatest comfort. The volume of stridor can paradoxically reduce as the obstruction increases due to the diminishing airflow. And no comfort should be taken from the fact that a child still looks pink. And so cyanosis is a very late event and suggests obstruction has been severe or prolonged. Cyanosis, you can see only the cyanosis, which is a sign. You can see only in the case of late stages of the obstruction. And in the early stages, the child may look pink and you may deviate from the diagnosis of the stridor. Investigations, imaging findings, mainly X-ray. And you can see here, this is the thyroid cartilage, this is the epiglottis, and this is the hyoid bone, and this is the cricoid cartilage, and this is the tracheal airway, that is lower airway. First sign is the steeple sign in the case of croup, and bulky lesions such as subglottic cysts and papillomatosis can also demonstrate the croup steeple sign. Significant stenosis may also be delineated. In older children, inspiratory and expiratory films may demonstrate diaphragmatic immobility on the side of obstruction. And in the case of foreign body, the diaphragmatic screening with the video fluoroscopy is a more sensitive technique. It is not important for you. And this is the steeple sign. It is very useful for you in the case of practical purpose. Steeple sign or pencil tip sign. You can see clearly here, this is the airway over the vertebra, and this is the airway. And there is the narrowing here, which is called a steeple sign or pencil tip sign. And in the case of epiglottitis, it is the thumbprint sign, which is enlarged epiglottis. These are all you have to go for airway fluoroscopy. And next one is the bronchography, may be performed using a non-ionic contrast media. And you can also go for the ultrasound of the vocal cords to look for any cyst, polyps, or papillomata. CT and MRI to rule out any obstructive lesions which can lead to the airway obstruction. But these are very rarely used. Most commonly used are the X-ray and direct examination with the endoscopes. Respiratory function test. You should also rule out the reflex. That is, gastroesophageal reflex can be assessed with the radiopaque contrast study, PH study, or the endoscopy. Occasionally, reflex may be a primary causative factor with the secondary reflex laryngitis. This is the important point. Endoscopy, the two principal concerns in the pediatric upper airway endoscopy are the safety and diagnostic accuracy. And suggested minimum equipment standards for the pediatric airway obstruction in the case of for using endoscopy are the adjustable laryngeal suspension system. There should be an adjustable laryngeal suspension system. And these are also not important for you. You can go for the awake flexible endoscopy in the office or ward. And ultra thin endoscopes with good optics and diameter of less than 2 mm. Neonates can be evaluated without the need for a general anesthetist. And peroral passage of an endoscope may be performed in the edentulous neonate using a finger between the gums to protect the instrument. And awake flexible endoscopy is most flexible or most feasible in the case of infant who may be swaddled under 9 to 12 months and in the older cooperative children. Office-based flexible endoscopy of the lower airway to the level of the carina has also been demonstrated as feasible and safe. And it is a picture showing the laryngotracheal bronchoscopy and is the gold standard in the assessment of the stridor child. It is a highly technical procedure, that is, the patient should be kept in GA and by using a suspension laryngoscope or a simple laryngoscope, which is used by the anesthetist, can be used by the ENT surgeon and can advance the endoscope through the upper airway. You can see here in the monitor. And in the case of second picture, suspension laryngoscope and a microscope. In the case of usage of the microscope, two hands can be kept free, whereas in the case of endoscope, only one hand is kept free. Anesthesia for upper airway endoscopy, mostly GA, it is mostly GA under general anesthesia. And airway technique, airway tube technique, jet ventilation, laryngeal mask airway. These are the three different types of introducing the anesthesia, anesthetic agent into the upper airways to keep the child in sleep. These are not so important for you. And bronchoscopy technique, you should remember this. And ventilating bronchoscopy is used, which provides a means of actively ventilating the patient if required. With spontaneous ventilation, smaller diameter rigid Hopkins rod telescope can be used with less trauma and reduces printing of the airway. An anesthetic laryngoscope can be used in the velicula to lift the larynx for the larynx forward while passing either the tip of the Hopkins rod or the bevel of the bronchoscope through the occipitals. If a bronchoscope is used, this can be performed under video control with the Hopkins rod coupled into the bronchoscope. This is the Hopkins rod, that is rigid endoscope, and this is the bronchoscope. Here it will be the light source, and here you can pass the anesthetic gas connection, and it is the bevel tip, and this is the working channel, and the flexible suction can be passed through this working channel. It is most commonly used for removal of the foreign bodies in the distal airway or the lower airway. The subglottics, trachea, carina, and the main bronchi are all systematically examined, and videographs or digital images recorded. Photo documentation of the endoscopy findings and printing of a compilation of the imaging is done. These are the bronchoscope sizes for different age groups of the children. Coming to the management of the acute upper airway, acute airway obstruction. In the acute situation, we have to assess what is the condition which is causing the obstruction by using history taking, and also the resuscitation will often proceed in the parallel. In the example of a child arriving in the emergency room with suspected croup, in the case of croup, the physician will be assessing the child for the degree of airway obstruction by gauging the resuscitation and dyspnea at the same time as asking the parent or carer for the length of the history and whether there is any possibility of foreign body inhalation. Because in the case of croup, you have to also rule out the foreign body inhalation. It can also lead to the upper airway obstruction, which can lead to the stridor. A nurse may be checking the oxygen saturation, setting up humidified air. This is a lot. In parallel, you have to go for history taking and assessment, and you have to rule out different conditions which can lead to the upper airway obstruction and or the airway obstruction and the stridor. And in parallel, we have to go for resuscitation and also managing the underlying condition. Medical management, oxygen therapy with an obstruction to airflow and normal alveolar function. Raising the concentration of the inspired oxygen will reduce the ventilatory requirement to maintain adequate oxygen saturation levels, but will not aid carbon dioxide clearance. You have to remember this, because when there is an airway obstruction with the normal alveolar function, only the increase in the concentration of the oxygen is enough, which can reduce the ventilator requirement to maintain adequate oxygen saturation, but it can't clear the carbon dioxide from the lungs. So long as the possibility of the hypercarbia is appreciated, oxygen is a useful drug in the treatment of the airway obstruction. How to also monitor the CO2 concentration within the blood by using any pulse oximeter or the CO2 monitor. And humidification, there is no objective evidence that raising the humidity of the inspired air is beneficial in the. This helium oxygen mixture, another one, Heliox, which is used, which can deliver the oxygen fastly. Pharmacotherapy, this is important. IV and oral steroids have been shown to be beneficial in the case of croup, and inhaled steroids have a similar effect. And this treatment may be with nebulized budesonide. As in the case of asthma, you can see this can also be used in the case of croup, or the intramuscular dexamethasone. These are the drugs which can be used in the case of emergency. And oral glucocorticoids such as dexamethasone and prednisolone may be the best options due to the ease of administration, widespread availability, and lower cost. Whereas inhaled or nebulized budesonide can be used in form for children with recurrent croup. This you have to remember. In the case of recurrent croup, the patient can be advised about the inhaled or nebulized budesonide and nebulized adrenaline, which is 400 microgram per kg or 0.4 ml per kg. Of 1:2000 to a maximum of 5 ml may result in a transient improvement within 10 to 30 minutes. So it can be used in the case of emergency situations. It can last up to 2 hours. This is most commonly used in the case of inflammatory component such as croup with moderate or severe distress. In the case of croup, these are the drugs, nebulized budesonide or the intramuscular dexamethasone or the oral corticosteroids. In the case of recurrent croup, inhaled or nebulized budesonide can be used. And in the case of emergency situation, nebulized adrenaline can also be used. Surgical management, the increasing use of intubation as an alternate to tracheostomy in acute obstruction has been brought about by advances in anesthesia and pediatric intensive management. Several subglottic stenosis, impacted foreign bodies, these are the conditions you have to remember. Severe subglottic stenosis, impacted foreign bodies, and advanced epiglottitis are key examples. Rarer conditions such as laryngeal atresia with ventilation being achieved via tracheoesophageal fistula necessitated tracheostomy. You have to remember this. In the case of subglottic stenosis, impacted foreign bodies, and advanced epiglottitis, you have to manage the patient in emergency situation, because the child can deteriorate rapidly in these conditions. Whereas in the case of laryngeal atresia, which is a rarer condition, and tracheoesophageal fistula, you have to go for directly to the tracheostomy to prevent further complications. Like in the case of tracheoesophageal fistula, it can lead to the aspiration and pneumonia. And in the case of laryngeal atresia, there can be complete absence of the connection with the upper airway. So you have to go for tracheostomy directly in these two conditions. Once the child has been slowly induced with the volatile anesthetic agent, it is possible to inspect the larynx and exclude the epiglottitis. Under GA, you have to examine the larynx completely, I have said in the previous slides, and it may be possible to manage the child using the nasopharyngeal airway under continuous positive airway pressure. If intubation is required, it is important to minimize any damage to the mucosa, because whenever there is a damage to the mucosa, it can lead to subglottic stenosis. And if it is an if and even if an intubation initial intubation is oral, which tends to be easier, the tube should be replaced with a nasal tube. This may be more secure and better tolerated. You have to replace it with the nasal tube, and sizing of the tube can be assessed by checking for a leak on the tracheobronchial secretion suction. If the secretions are very tenacious and there is still an element of airway obstruction, ventilating bronchoscope should be passed to exclude the bacterial tracheitis or the foreign body. You have to examine the secretions, and if there are thick secretions, you have to rule out bacterial tracheitis and foreign body. And in the emergency tracheostomy, one of the conditions where there is an emergency situation, we have to go for emergency tracheostomy, like laryngeal atresia and tracheoesophageal fistula. We have to go for tracheostomy directly. You can go for external tracheostomy or the percutaneous tracheostomy. Thank you. But remember these conditions which can lead to the airway obstruction. Glottis, supraglottis, glottis and subglottis. And the supraglottic part and the glottic part can lead to the laryngeal obstruction and can lead to the stridor, that is inflatory stridor. Whereas in the case of subglottic or upper trachea, there can be biphasic stridor. Whereas in the case of lower trachea, it is expiratory stridor. Lower trachea example is mostly asthma, which can lead to the expiratory stridor. And their voice is changed only in the case of glottic involvement, hoarseness of voice. These are the conditions. These are the nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal causes, the coronary atresia, craniofacial abnormalities, micrognathia or glossoptosis. That is in the case of oral cavity or oral oropharynx or the nasopharynx. In the case of neonates, the acquired conditions are neonatal rhinitis, whereas in the case of children, the acquired conditions are allergic rhinitis, adenoiditis, adenotonsillar hypertrophy, foreign body. Whereas in the case of laryngeal causes, congenital causes are laryngomalacia. It is the most common condition which can lead to the stridor. And vocal gut palsy, another most common condition. And third one is next one, next, these are the minor conditions which can lead to the upper airway obstruction. Congenital conditions which can lead to the upper airway obstruction. Acquired neonates, in the case of neonates, acquired condition most commonly laryngeal cause which is causing the obstruction are intubation trauma, which can lead to a subglottic stenosis. And in the case of children, it is the laryngeal causes are intubation trauma, croup, laryngotracheal bronchitis, recurrent respiratory papillomatosis, foreign body, epiglottitis. Whereas in the case of tracheal causes, the congenital causes which can cause most commonly is obstruction are primary tracheomalacia, that is collapse of the trachea. There will be smooth softening of the trachea, similar to the laryngomalacia, where there is a softening of the upper laryngeal structures. You can see clearly in the endoscopic picture, there will be omega-shaped epiglottis in the case of laryngomalacia. And secondary tracheomalacia due to the vascular compression, like in the case of aneurysms, and acquired neonatal conditions. The tracheal causes are post-intubation or instrumentation or tracheal stenosis. And in the case of children, it is croup, that is laryngotracheal bronchitis, and foreign bodies. These are the conditions you have to remember. Thank you.